I said good day, sir!
Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the defense powered by Razor as well as BenQ. We are renewed, we are revived, and the vocal cords have been replaced with one day's rest. We are here for Ublis going up against Absolute Legends. So the Germans get to go up against the Australians here in the defense group stages. If you want to keep up with all the details, go to the-defense.com. It is your place to catch up all the details. If you can't find that, join.com, your normal home where you find all this good chisel. You just click on the tournaments tab, and it'll take you straight there. Let's jump ourselves inside the game. In a couple of moments' time, our last player is going to connect in. I'll start off the captain's draft. But in the meantime, I'm going to introduce to you the guy who I can hear here in the background right now. It is my co-caster. He's been joining me for a lot of these games right now, saving my voice over the last couple of days, and we'll be getting to have his insight into this game. It is Ham Sandwich. Welcome back to the broadcast, man.
Hey, how are you? Just let me know if it's too loud in the background, and I'll close my window. There's like a big garbage truck going by or something.
If there's a big garbage truck going past, then you leap for that window. You bang that window shut and say, you know what? Nothing is going to interrupt the audio quality of this live stream because it's just too important, man. It's just too important. That's good to be back, by the way, guys. I hope you had a good rest yesterday and actually tuned in to, well, you might have not had a rest. I was watching the live streams. We had, I believe, who do we end up having stream
out? Sheever did a couple of the games.
Sheever did a couple?
She did the second and third game of the day.
Mm-hmm. And I know we also had, not coming to mind. But yeah, we had a couple of other guys streaming it out in multiple languages as well, as we always do. And if you're tuning in from inside the game client, hello to you guys as well. I know you can't see me wave, but for the people watching on the live stream over at joinedata.com, then yeah, you can see me wave. Let's check out our draft, though. I want to check out our draft and who is playing. You did mention before that Risk is standing in for Bleak this evening. Bleak, normally the big farming hero for the Absolute Legend side, so we might see them switch up a little bit with what heroes are going to play in this game. For Ublis, we know a lot of them. Alex, Leaf, Pass, RMN, and Chill, who I got a funny feeling it's actually not Chill.
What gives you that feeling?
Because the words Kurokai were mentioned in the chat before.
And yeah, I heard that as well. And of course, there's a
truck going by.
I will close my window and be right back.
We'll wait for that. Actually, no, it is actually Chill, a guy called Thornston. Chill Kuro is in the list, but he is not playing today. So they are playing with five normal men. They've actually got a roster of seven players, which is slightly hilarious, but hey, if it's seven players is what it takes to make sure you got a full roster, then seven players is what you do. So yeah, we get to look through our draft so far. So Ublis betting at the Darkseer, Chen as well as Enchantress. So normal junglers as well as the Darkseer. At this point, AL is currently debating if they should ban out the CK. They've already taken out Lycan as well as Broodmother. But really, CK has to go into that ban. We've seen him carry so many late games, Ham.
Actually, there's one game yesterday, MTW versus Empire, and obviously get banned out here, but MTW and Empire did not ban CK in the first phase, and I don't think he even got picked in the first phase. He got banned in the second phase, which I found insane.
It's always very dependent, though, on the CK, because we were talking about it during the Counter Logic games, where we saw one game in one night where Counter Logic Gaming got completely and utterly annihilated due to the fact that CK never got anything. He never did anything. And then we saw another CK game where 40 minutes in, CK was basically unstoppable. It's this different thing of what do you have as a counter? That's what I think I actually answered in that huge Ask Me Anything thing on Reddit yesterday. things you do when you have a day off casting. One of the questions was like, is there any such thing as an overpowered hero? And technically, no. There is no such thing as an overpowered hero. There's just a hero you have to actively counter and find a counter for him. Sometimes it takes a while before you find a counter which works properly with an entire lineup, and during that time, that hero is always banned or always removed because there's just that problem in dealing with him. And yeah, well, CK, he's one of those kind of guys which MTW, they would have probably just thought about and just worked out, you know what, it's not worth picking up. If someone picks up a Shadow Demon, we're in trouble. Considering AL can go for that insane combo as well. I'm talking about Shadow Demon Disruption, Lost Shrek's stun as well as the Invoker Sunstrike. There's options for them right now, while Ubalus go out with Prophet, Enigma, as well as Windrunner. So they've got a lot of side lane potential. In fact, all three heroes can go that hard lane on the bot for the Dire side. But we're looking at Enigma jungle more than likely, and Prophet and Windrunner, we'll wait and see.
Yeah, another thing that should be noted is that all of AL today are playing from Australia. Bleak normally plays for them, and he's their resident Canadian player, so he does really well on the US servers. But today they've got everybody from Australia, so we may not see as many of those micro-intensive heroes like we see out of Bleak.
Yeah.
That's really dependent on his ping.
Yeah, it is always the problem for AL, but they were talking about it during DreamHack, in fact, just how much they had to change. I don't know if you guys checked it out, but there was one of the interviews we did over on the joindata.com. It's on YouTube channel as well as on our VOD database. But one of the interviews we did with AL when they were practicing in the LAN cafe, and they were talking about just how much they have to change their strats when they go from playing with delay to not playing with delay. It's a very, very different game style. You go from this spammy AoE push kind of deal to a more focused fire kind of thing, where you can do these short little movements you need to do to bring down the opposition and make those openings where you normally you wouldn't. Which did force there was a time a couple of months ago, well, actually probably when AL first really came onto the scene for Dota 2, so that was actually a decent time ago. We're talking about like maybe 6 months ago now, when no team could really find a counter to them, because it was just this continuous push, blast, couldn't really fight team fight. No one really found a good answer to it. And AL, they always found their opening, they found the economic advantage. And for them, that was the way they played. And then people worked out what the hell they were doing and worked out how to counter it. And yeah, well, AL, so far, they've got some decent team fight. In fact, they've got a lot of decent team fight if that ES gets a blink dagger up. And they've also got good control over their lanes very early on. And they haven't even shown their last two heroes.
AL here bans out Lone Druid, which is still a strong pick here for Ubalist if they opt to go for it. But Ubalist taking out some of the solo lane heroes in Queen of Pain and Nightstalker. Both can solo up a lane fairly easily, especially the Queen of Pain. And we've also got them taking out a lot of the mid-game aggression. And AL really likes their mid-game aggression, so these, I think, are very good bans here. But you bust.
Mm-hmm. So we got out NS Cop Lone Druid. Finally being banned by AL. They must really be fearing the overpush, but okay. Sorry, I also got a little bit distracted during that one. It's what happens when you try and multitask, guys. And you're a man. If you have genitalia, multitasking is not successful. Especially when you try and do it on four different screens.
Both men and women have genitalia.
That is true. Let's not go into the biology lesson, except for Windrunner, who's obviously showing us her other parts. But it is obscured by her name a lot. Lena is the only one that really gets over the top of her description. And how do we just then go into the talk about breasts? So
that was all you. That was all you.
Man, that is so not me. That was all Valve. That was Valve when they changed the way the portraits work. They squashed them up, and they made them into these card kind of things where breasts are always visible. It's what every gamer nerd always dreams of. Anyway, Shadow Demon now being banned out, so we start to look down the lines of a Morphling or an Anti-Mage for AL. Whenever I see him being banned out, those two heroes, well, one of them will generally follow directly after. And Ubalus will probably want to be going for the Morphling themselves, only because it does give them that early game push and presence. Where AL, they've got themselves a semi-turtle lineup. It's a semi-turtle. I say semi. It can be played other ways as well. But it does lead along the lines of having that big hard carry later on in the game. So they could also look at the Lich as well as Void combo if they want to go down those lines.
Ubalist.
It's Ubalist. Because it's supposed to have. Okay. Is it an Unglau? Is an Unglau?
On the U?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll work on my German. They've gone for a ton of global presence here with both Tinker and Prophet. So expect them to be exceptionally annoying here to absolute legends. Mm-hmm.
Man, they'll want to be. This is something, actually, this is a very, very similar lineup to what MTW ran against NextKZ. NextKZ had a rather kind of like turtle lineup where they could push if they really, really wanted to. Obviously, you got a little track, so it was very easy to push. But in this scenario, you've got Tinker and Profit, and this is where the whole we can turtle a little bit falls down. Because you got Tinker and Profit who can split push the top and the bot lane. And because of that, you can't really team up as five and find that way. The kind of like total defensive lineups you can build is more rotated around making sure that you can fight as five. Because when you fight as five, generally you'll win. That's the whole thing. It's a controlling lineup you generally get. So Absolute Legends got to look at this and say, well, we're going to get split pushed. So we either have options where we have heroes that are able to snipe. So we look at Klinks, we look at Ricky Maru, we look down those lines, Bounty Hunter, for instance.
And there is the Bounty Hunter.
There we go, Bounty Hunter is there. So they want to be hunting around the map, looking for these heroes, which are out of position, which gives them the advantage to then push. Look for that profit in the wrong place.
We've also got a lot of long-range abilities here out of Absolute Legends. We've got the Earthshaker Fissure, Tornado and Cold Snap both have very long range for the Invoker. So expect Tinker to have to take an early Force Staff in order to be absolutely safe when TPing in and out of lanes. Mm. Or else they're just going to use their long range things, their long range skills, and stop the Tinker from TPing, and they'll get themselves an easy kill that way.
That is actually one thing to also bear in mind too. The Bounty Hunter is a double-edged sword, because with his track, like Tinker might want to force staff and TP out, that's fine. But wherever he TPs to, AL will know about it if they have the track up on him. They get that global vision from that, technically, from wherever Prophet and Tinker is going to take off to. I know Bucking Mad and I had a nice, I don't know if he's tuning in, but shout out to Bucking Mad if he's currently tuning in. But we had a very lengthy discussion after the International Qualifiers Grand Final game. And a lot of it came down to talking about how they're able to pull off this maneuver of just this split push lane. And he said the biggest factor when you go for a split push is the ability to be able to TP in while not being seen, or like knowing that if you do TP in, you could be ganked or you might not be ganked. And the ability to say, no, I won't be ganked, means you can TP, push hard, use your abilities, TP back out again. So it's going to be coming down to a lot of warding out from Ublis to make sure this happens. But then again, they get countered as well by the fact that AL will be walking around with a Bounty Hunter with a track. So, yeah, Gem will be a very, very big key item for the Dire side to get up very, very early on.
Yeah, we also have to remember that Tinker not only can TP to the Creep Wave, but he can also TP to Furion's Treants or to Enigma's Eidolons. So look for Tinker to be TPing into the woods on one of those units rather than necessarily right into the lane each time.
I'm also being corrected by the project manager of Join Dota, who's currently tuning in. Hello, Mooseman. Who's actually supposed to be Ubalist. So it's actually meant to be like
Ubalist
instead of
You instead of or the other way around.
Ubalist. Okay, we can go with that one.
We can call them the Germans.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, let's check out this top lane. Alex, he actually going to get that initial stun on RMN. If he has a shackle, he's not going to use it. Shaitan takes some initial damage, but RMN almost had the line there for Shaitan. But they know that Bounty Hunter's snapping up at the top lane. Let's run through very, very quickly who's going to be playing what. I want to wait and see what Shaitan's going to try and do with this, because his Ghost Ward's about to wear off in a moment. Have they got sentries here? Nope, it's normal Observer Wards. Oh, man. They still get enough stuns before he gets out. And Alex will ward back to base and just regen him up and then come back out again. But Shaitan will end up playing down the wards. But yeah, Absolute Legends, I'm going to run through these boys. So the G-Germans can be yours. Now, Shaitan will be taking up that top lane as Bounty Hunter. He'll be supported by Godot, who was the Lich. So Lich was the final one to come up. In towards middle lane, solo mid going Exhort Invoker will be Musica. Down towards our bottom lane, Snoopy as the lovable, very, very furry Earthshaker. And then down towards the bottom lane as well. Following up is the man who has not played for Absolute Legends for a while, but he will rejoin them for this game, and that is Risk.
All right, for top lane, for Ubalist, we've got the Tinker, played by Leaf here. Chill's going to be taking up the jungle on his Enigma. We've got Alex headed back up top to support the Tinker with his Vengeful Spirit. And we've got Pass, bottom lane, as the Prophet, and lastly, RMN soloing mid as the Windrunner.
There's going to be a fun little battle here. I love Windrunners in the solo mid because it's just so easy to get away with that Windrun ability, but it also becomes a bit of a... It's a bit of a, do you want to attack me? Do you really want to attack me? Like, I can chase you also with my Windrun. I can be aggressive with this thing, but then again, Musica will want to be trying to bait it out. That's why we're seeing him come in really, really close, or as close as he dares to the creep wave, just so we can get those last right clicks in on RMN, just in case. You know what? A little bit of damage here or there might force him to use a couple of those consumables, and that'll make him a little bit more itchy on the trigger finger for Windrun.
And you notice how this ward didn't seem to actually block the camp, the top lane ward.
Really? Yeah,
because it spawned. And the two sentry wards that were purchased to counter it didn't see it either.
It must just be only a couple of mils too high.
It must be a fraction out of the block range.
That is actually the line there. If I remember correctly, well, hang on, the top line. Don't take my bottom line. that's the line right there for where you can pull the creep wave out. That's why it's possible, even when you're attacking the creep wave and you pulled your own down, you can find yourself with a double pull. Just if the creeps are high enough up into the top, which is kind of really awesome, because you don't get that kind of space in the bottom lane as the Radiant. You've really got to pull it past that this horrible, horrible line here. If the creep wave doesn't really get past there, then you've got no real chance of double spawning it. By the way, you have to imagine where I'm drawing. You should know the pull spots as well.
I do, and I'm doing a good job imagining.
That's good, man. It's pure imagination. What was that song done by Tori or whatever her name was?
So we're seeing another March build out by Tinker. We saw actually Sox yesterday play a March first Tinker. He actually went March missile, whereas this Tinker has gone March laser.
It's kind of fair enough considering the lane he's on. Like, sure, he can do a little bit of damage to the Lich with the rockets, but Shaitan's ability to jump inside that Ghost Walk will evade most of the rockets that will come off. So he goes to the ones which is the Instacast, the one that he knows he can get off on that Bounty Hunter, and also the one which makes Bounty Hunter very, very cautious when he goes inside the Ghost Walk. He still takes damage from the March and the Machines. So it's a catch 22 for what you really want, and in this case too. Also, Leaf, once he gets that farm up, he knows he can protect every tier 1 tower if AL ever decide to push. And AL don't really have a great pushing lineup. All they've really got is Lashrak Edict. And that's why Risk is on that bottom lane, trying to get as many levels as he possibly can early on.
Yeah, and Ubalist here have a much better push lineup because they've got so many summons, as well as the March of the Machines, which just completely destroys entire creep waves.
Mm-hmm. Surprised.
Not only can they...
Have you noticed Alex's build as well?
No, I haven't, actually.
He put 1 point to Vengeance Aura very early on.
Rather than Terror.
Yeah.
That, to me, shows that they are wanting to push very fast, or very soon, into the game. And we've got a Prophet TP.
Yeah, they're going to go for top lane. They're going to go for Godot. There goes the Sprout to hold him in place. VS follows up. Stun Godot did his way through the trees a little bit. But there's just too much damage, and VS will take the first blood. Shaitan's looking to hunt the Enigma down. What's he got? He's got one Jinder as well as Toss, and it's almost enough. Back inside the Invis is one right-click away to kill
up
the Enigma. And there's a kill from the Bounty Hunter. Getting the right-click out. Now the Fissure flies out, and actually Paz in a really, really bad position. Shaitan trying to do what he can to that Vengeful Spirit. Sunstrike's going to fall, runs over Paz's head just on the edge, in fact, to get the kill. Shaitan going back into Invis, running away from the conversions. Managing to pick up the VS in the back end of play. So it becomes three. On that kill, there was a 3-1 trade in the top lane for AL.
Yeah, there's some great TPs. You had Earthshaker TP in from the bottom lane. Didn't have any items except for that TP that he bought at the side shop. Came in, was able to secure not only the one kill, but also get the other one once Lich came in. They picked up the Prophet.
When you also think about it too, like the amount of time which Lashrak had on that bottom lane to farm up. Now he's up to level 6, 3 points in Edict, just harassing down the tower. But nice maneuvering there of the Treants bypass to make sure they soak up a little bit of the Edict damage. But it ended up being a 4v4 fight in the top lane. But Invoker never had to leave. He had that Sunstrike to help him out. There's only three heroes from AL that went up there when there's four from Ubalist. which means they miss out a little bit in the lanes. And that's why they've won. Actually, it was 1K advantage as far as experience goes up for AL. That's after that engagement, but it goes back down again now that everyone settles back into their lanes. I actually expected a little bit more to go.
There's also the Enigma who's getting experience from the jungle, whereas AL doesn't have a foresting hero.
We're going to see this top tier 1 tower take a fall. It's very little that can stop this right now, and it's actually a second level into the aura. Instead of going into second level in Magic Missile, throws away the 175 damage just so this push can happen. March on the Sheens doesn't
benefit from it.
No, it doesn't. It's
but all the conversions, like the Treants and the Eidolons will.
That is true, but I don't know if that's 100% worth it when you've got an extra 75 damage you can have up your sleeve. Not to mention, I think it's a little bit longer on the stun. Yeah, the duration, now we go up to level 2 for it. But duration goes up, it's only a fraction of the amount. Risk actually in a lot of trouble on the bottom lane. Locked inside the Sprout, but looks like Prophet's in worse trouble. Risk, is he good enough? No. Nature's Prophet gets his revenge after death, but doesn't get any experience for his efforts.
And that, if we look at our middle lane, we've got Invoker and Windrunner are actually very, very even. Invoker did get that one kill in top from his Sunstrike. But this is a very, very even lane. It's going to be interesting to see exactly what happens, because there's actually been no heroes in mid other than these two. Nobody's rotated in for a gank. Nobody's left for a gank. Windrunner's sort of been controlling runes, but that's it. Mm-hmm. And looks like we got a smoke here now for the Invoker in mid.
Yep, they're going to come in from the high ground. Need to land that initial stun, but that requires Musica to basically go down that ramp he's currently sitting on. And in comes Alex, and there he goes, down the ramp. Now they can make the move. VS done, and Nimue will follow up with his Malifaux power shot as well. All they needed was that little bit of a high ground advantage and make sure he can't get back in range of the tower in time. And that's going to be a tier 1 tower in mid lane as well.
Prophet taking a fall on bottom, maybe.
Maybe. Sprouts himself up so he can TP out, and Risk can't see him, and Risk doesn't have a stun. Now he can, but actually, that was a really short Sprout. Level 1 for that. T1 tower brought down the middle lane. And Risk really wants this bottom tower, but he's not going to get it. Not in this wave, at least.
Yubelis has got to be careful here, because this Prophet is being shut down a ton in bottom lane. I mean, he's sort of been TPing around and getting levels elsewhere, but he can't defend this tower alone.
Support's got... Well, then again, he's never alone. He's always got four trees. And they soak up a lot of the damage from Risk. Even with a level 4 Edict, if those trees stay closer towards Risk, that tower will remain up.
I don't know. AL may bring another hero down just to make sure that tower does fall. I mean, it's deniable at this point, so Yubelis can take that route if they choose to.
They gotta know something is up though. Passy's a long way down right now, and Snoopy is preparing himself for the gank, and he doesn't really know there's another three heroes. Nice Fissure, and this is gonna hold VS out. He's still gonna get that stun. The Echo Slam, Shackle will latch on Risk, and Risk is gonna go down right now, being blocked up by the trees. He cannot get away. Wonderful micro up there by Pass. Snoopy goes the only way he knows to get out. Downside the trees, he will not have enough time to TP out. Double kill for RMM with the haste rune, making sure he can get there in time, and then follows up with an amazing shackle on Godot. VS follows up with a stun as well. Triple kill for the Windrunner for Ubalist.
Aw, better luck next life.
I mean, they traded the Prophet, but he's back now, and they're going to push really, really hard on this tower.
That was the exact opening that Ubalist wanted. And it came from AL just wanting to make a play. They didn't really realize how much support was down there on that bottom lane. And that's the vision. There's one ward up from the Radiant side and just watching the top area, but when you've got this global TP that is possible or a possible move on smoke, it's just so difficult. And now it will be global TP. Boots of Travel are flying out towards the top lane. So Tinker gets that at 9 minutes 50. Really early boots with the Sol Ring.
That is really early. And that tower fell so fast once there was an opening. Pass did a good job baiting for that teamfight, because that's essentially what he was bait. And then AL loses 3 for it.
Yeah. Well, that's that power of now level 4 Vengeance Aura on VS. So UORI is exactly what they wanted. They wanted that extra damage. Shaitan wants to come back in again. He's going to be really, really cautious. There's currently a Sentry Ward here. And Enigma is sticking around it so he can try and get this stun off. But Ublis are being held off a little bit. You got Godot and Risk, and Risk with 2 levels up in Lightning now. He's moved himself from Split Earth into Lightning, realizing he needs a counter push. while Mystica continues to farm up there in that middle lane. And that's the reason why...
rotating.
Yeah, there's a rotate mid. Enigma's got to get that initial stun, though. And Prophet's going to TP teleport in. Chitana's here, starts off with the track. Pass up on that high ground. Now he's going to go over the sprout. Passes here. And Mystica, Black Hole will go, but Lejomba's going to cancel it off and then bounce back up to Alex. Double kill for Godot, the oldie of his life right there. While Pass is on the run from Chitana. Jinder's up in 1 second. Now it's there. Sunstrike's going to come in as well. The track keeps that vision up on him. Shaka won't latch. Risk looking for a stun. Now he can do it on RMN. Rockets are flying out. Be a lot of damage on a Risk. Almost enough to kill him off. And the frost from Lich, and he will go down. Just stopping Pass from following down. And Chitana looks like he's not given up just yet. He's looking at Leaf here in the middle lane, but he's going to TP himself out. Chitana can't go into that March of Machines. It's a problem for Bounty Hunter. He just cannot fight there. But AL want a straggler. They want to find someone who just overextends themselves.
Yeah, we had a buyback there from Enigma as well as the Invoker. And I don't think either of them really got what they were looking for. We got Chitana going on the Enigma here.
Wonderful fissure. Absolutely wonderful fissure. It's going to cost Bounty Hunter his life. And holy crap, 60 HP. Snoopy's also blocked in by his own fissure. He wants one last right click on the Enigma. But it's not going to happen. The chain was right. Now music is going to come in. There's his right click. Tika TPing onto one of the range creeps. And there's his spread as well. Prophet comes back into the game. And that's going to be the death of the Invoker. All he wanted was the Enigma. And all he got was death. As well as the Enigma scalp.
Yeah, that's a great fissure there by Musica to lock down the Enigma, but they didn't realize that Windrunner was close and had a power shot lined up perfectly for the Bounty Hunter.
Mm-hmm. He thought he could buy his teammates enough time.
And then you just see what a solo Windrunner against a solo Invoker suddenly turns into Prophet and Tinker being there.
it's a painful experience, man. It's a really, really painful experience. And how are we actually looking? Because it's one thing I haven't looked at just yet, and it's something which will probably change in the future. 5k experience, 5k advantage as far as gold goes for absolute legends. And you got to remember Chitana's track. Later in the game, that's going to start to really, really add up. But Ublis also having 4.5k as far as experience goes going their way. It's looking really good for them. But actually, Risk has got some good farm too. 54 for 6 for him. So I guess he's actually all... Well, he's almost the most farmed here on the map. It's Enigma who's only taking the cake. But you can be pretty sure that Risk would have a higher gold per minute. Especially with Enigma's 3 deaths.
One thing that I have noticed is that every time I look at Bounty Hunter, he's invisible chasing a hero down. And it really hasn't paid off for him. Well, I mean, he has to be scared. But, I mean, he needs to farm as well. He needs creep kills. And he has sort of got... He's got 2 kills and a death, but hasn't really been farming all that well. It's only at 28 creeps.
Yeah, it's kind of like the sacrifice you get from the Bounty Hunter. You realize that he needs those kills. We're talking about the very, very start of this game where he needs to be on the hunt. If he's not in that presence looking for heroes to kill, then he's just not as effective in the game. But that's where the power comes from. It's like Clinks. It's like, well, great during teamfight. He can get a decent amount of burst damage off. But his real power is when he finds somebody caught out of position, able to kill them off, and that makes the entire opposition then play defensive. Same with Stealth Assassin. You know he has permanent invisibility, except when he's obviously attacking. But it's that thing which just makes you always look over your back. Just make sure it's like, is there someone behind me? Should I really be warding? Should I spend the money on this ward because I really don't feel safe? That's the kind of presence which Chitana needs to have on this map. And that's the reason why he's hunting as much as he is. That presence can make up for farm in a lot of these lanes. Because you're already seeing right now, VS and Enigma, they don't really want to cross the river. They're not quite sure about it. RMN, he's moving around only because he's got a haste rune. That's the only reason why he's on that side of the river.
We've got a smoke up here from Lich and Earthshaker. Just patrolling their jungle, I think, to secure the lane for Bounty Hunter a little bit.
Well, here
and they might actually go on this Tinker.
Yeah, Tinker's going to TP in, so Chitana will start with the track. And they're going to find the Ventral Spirit a little bit higher up. They're going to get that Frost. Got to get that Frost. Fissure. Maximum range hitches on Alex. Now the Sunstrike as well is going to be a little bit too far off. Rockets will fly. Alex just wants one stun. and he'll get it on Goat. Our Prophet's going to TP in to help out. The support coming in from the west, and there goes the Sprout just holding Snoopy in place. Shaka won't latch. Power shot flies through, not hitting anybody. Shaitan back to Invis. Korea flying in from the Dire side into the middle of the war zone. Leavis here, and they're looking for Snoopy. They do pick him off, and Nima cutting through the trees so they can try and find someone else. That's Lich as well as the ES, who has taken a fall for the price of a VS, but that's a lot of support TP towards the bottom lane.
Yeah, I mean, Ubalist is doing a great job protecting their teammates. Whenever they seem to be at a disadvantage, teammates are close by. They had the Prophet TP in, they had Enigma rotate down, they had Windrunner rotate down. And as a result, they don't actually take a loss in their teamfight. They manage to somehow get up on top. And that's just their ability to move around the map, not only with their two global heroes, but even their non-global heroes are doing a great job getting around the map.
Love this pressure here in the middle lane by Ubalist. Sunstrike just having a bit of a search for anybody they can find. But AL, they were looking to trade just then. They knew the tier 2 tower on bottom lane was doomed and they couldn't defend it. So they tried to push out the mid, but Fortification was there. Tinker came in with a double rocket, and that made Risk really, really low, and Invoker tried to chase him as well, and he copped a couple of hits as well. And it was at that point that things just didn't really work out for AL, and still not a single tier 1 tower has gone down for the Dire side. And that's just this global counter push, as well as global push from the Dire side. How do you really push against that?
Well, you don't, obviously. That's what we've seen. And we're going to see a Roshan fight, potentially.
Yeah, it will be. Well, not a Roshan fight. I think Ublis will have this free. There's just no way that AL can get themselves in a position where they can fight this. Ublis already did the right job. They push at the top, they push at the bottom, and they decent control over the mid, which gives them all the space in the world to do exactly what they just did. Aegis the Immortal now on top of the Tinker.
Tinker's the right choice for this as well, because he's the one who wants to TP in.
Oh, Shaitan.
Malphus.
Oh, Shaitan. If they only had themselves a Sentry Ward.
And Vengeful Spirit goes and buys Sentry Wards right after.
Just one of those moments where it's like, if we had a Sentry Ward, then that was a guaranteed kill, because Iron Man got the shackle directly after went to Ghost War, because he still knew the angle of him, and you can shackle up invisible units. And they just had nothing else they could really pop unless they really wanted to commit a black hole to that. They weren't 100% sure he was still there.
Well, black hole doesn't reveal invis anyway, so they'd have to hope that they were going to kill him.
They still have a decent amount of damage. Now Enigma. He's going to have to use it right now. 2 heroes are going to be there. Sunstrike will go through. Lichom is going to bounce back up again. Back in the Ublis side. And there is no here creeps there to tank up that damage. Ublis took a damn tonk of damage from that one. ES will take a fall as well. Wrist trying to run away from the Martian Machines, but Leaf is there. Double kill for him. RMM being hunted by Shaitan. Tosses back up again. Invoker gets a double kill. And they'll get back up towards the high ground. Being chased by trees, but Musica will TP back out again. They got Raxus to defend, but 3 for the price of 2.
That was a good quick black hole cancel there by the Lich using his Chain Frost.
I don't know if they've changed it, but it doesn't really look like when the Lich ultimate hits that the stun hits.
It stuns instantly.
They've changed it again, have they? Because I know
as soon as he casts it, it stuns.
Because in Warcraft 3, it was like that, and when Dota 2 first introduced the Lich, it was different. The stun happened when the Chain Frost hit. It wasn't that instant cancel.
So Valve has changed it so that it matches Dota 1.
Okay. Fish on the top lane. Wow, how much does ES really want to Echo Slam that? How much did he not have Echo Slam?
Yeah, he used it last fight. This is the power of Ubalist, that they can, even if they don't necessarily win a fight completely, they can still transition into their push exceptionally quickly.
Mm-hmm. Even if they do have to buy back for it. And you look at that bottom lane, it's getting momentum, but AL have TP'd everybody to the top lane. They want to initiate right now. There's no Lich ultimate, there's no ES ulti. There goes a Fissure. Meteorite going to take a fall as well. More and more tracks, so Ublis have got nowhere to really hide. But they know it as well. They want to force this down, but the counter push from AL is just too strong for them. And that's why they all fall back now.
I think they may actually try and do a little bit in bottom, because they know that AL is defending the top tower.
Then they got to come in range of the tier threes, and support can come pretty fast with that. That's the power of Ubilis right now, where they control majority of the map. If they start trying to like go in or do any form of damage towards the tier three towers, then they kind of lose their field advantage, which is basically they control the jungle on both Radiant as well as Dire.
Yeah, but this is the problem that Z Nation ran into yesterday, is that they took down all six outer towers, and then they got stuck and couldn't ever push into the base. And I think they waited too long. I mean, you still got Tinker Aegis. You've got VS with Vengeance Aura starting to get all these key items up, like the pipes up on the Windrunner. You got to make a play for the base at some point. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if they... you can't let Bounty Hunter get big, and you can't let Leshrac get big, or else that's how the game ends.
Well, Music is also getting pretty big. You notice he's the first one to crack the 100 CS. Even though they're four kills behind, Music is still finding this farm. Like, we've got Mech, we've got Four Staff. He's looking nice. Shaitan, sure, he's only got drums and treads, but he's still got 1400 gold. And it's still 9.5 away. There goes Shaitan. Instantly inside a Ghost Walk. Knows the dust's going to pop, and he is revealed down there. He's going to get back out again, avoiding the power shot. Now on the run from Leaf. He'll have a laser in a moment. He wants to pop off the rockets, but that dust's going to wear off in a couple of seconds, and Ghost walks back up again. Shaitan managed to escape with a lot of support coming in from Ubilist. But then again, it's so easy to go anywhere with support from Ubilist.
Yeah, every 1v1 fight is suddenly a 3v1 fight.
Mm-hmm. They're looking at top lane. VS got to get this done. Maybe even start off with a swap at that range. Four staff down by Leaf. Probably going to TP, and Musica four stars himself away. Really ballsy to use that early on, knowing that Prophet was going to try and sprout him. Probably realize, so he's got the space. Shaitan going to harass here a little bit on RMN. Now the power shot's gone. So crit, toss as well. A toss. Yep, there goes the toss. A little bit of damage, and he's going to TP himself back out of this, realizing the toss is down, so he can't get out to safety.
Yeah, I don't think Bounty Hunter has nearly enough damage to take out the Windrunner at this point.
No, he doesn't, but he can force him off the lane. And that's more farm time, and this is that global as well. Windrunner tracked up, TP towards the top, and revealed the fact that VS was TPing back up. There was a VS or Enigma TP back up towards that top lane. So because of that, AL knew they're not alone. There's a lot more heroes up here than what's really been led on. So the Forge Spirits are doing the scouting for them. Shaitan continues to farm up that bottom lane. And while Leaf can push out the middle lane, there's already Snoopy there prepared to defend it. And he's now got Blink Dagger. I like this from Snoopy as well. Holding it on the courier, not showing it out. So AL will look to initiate after Snoopy taking care of this middle lane.
And Tinker's headed to push out bottom lane, just to make sure that the Bounty Hunter doesn't have nearly as much free farm as he'd like. Bounty Hunter's getting closer to a big item as well. He's at 2,300 gold, so you could see him pick up a Yasha, or he has opted actually to go for that Black King bar.
Waiting for Music to initiate right now on the top. It's two heroes just standing straight behind Godot and Riss. They both want to have a crack at this. They need the Cold Snap to hit an RMN. They need him to actually be instantly stunned up and hold Eld in place. And that's going to be Shaitan. Shaitan's going to come in. He'll start the engagement on RMN. And there's the initial crit. Now the Cold Snap to follow up, but that wind run makes it so easy for him to run himself away. The toss slowed him down for a little bit, and Shaitan's going to keep up. There's a tier 1 tower there, and they don't know how much support is there from Ubilist.
And they're afraid of the two TPs from Tinker and from Prophet.
Mm-hmm. So they fall themselves back. And where is this Earthshaker? He's still sitting behind play.
He doesn't want to get his Blink Dagger revealed just yet. Not until they're ready to fight.
Yep.
Needs it to be a surprise.
So now
see
the time.
Him even here.
Are they going to try? They're going to finally bring down the tier 2 tower on the top lane. Finally. No.
You gotta be careful. They haven't seen Earthshaker in a while, and at this point, Ubilis might be worried that he's either at Blink or close to Blink.
They'd have to know. With Earthshaker being missing this long, they have to know what's up. And that's probably the reason why they're playing it safe. Major's Prov is farming up to his level 3 Necro book. He's currently got level 2 on it. So they're getting the pushing power out from their lineup. They're continuing to farm up inside the jungle. PKB from Enigma now being 1,500 away for him. And working towards the sheepstick for Iron Man. So he's still got himself a decent way. We're looking at 3,200, maybe 3,300 in total for him to farm up. And that's a long time to go. In the meantime, AL, they're not getting any farm whatsoever. They're holding so many heroes up on this tier 2 tower on the top lane.
And they're sort of being put into a stalemate position.
They did
smoke just there.
Yep, they want to blink and get that initial stun on Iron Man. So there's a call snap, Fissure as well. And Iron Man will take a fall. Lostrak with a follow-up stun. So they finally make a move on that top, and which means they can push this tier 1 tower now. But while that's happening, Lee pushes at the mid tower. So it's going to be Shaitan to go back in towards that mid lane to defend it. And he knows it as well.
Yeah, Shaitan sort of had the time of his life just farming up creeps, not really having to worry about enemy heroes. Because his team's putting enough pressure on the tier 1 tower here that Ubalist has to respond. And still, they don't want to really commit. There's this sort of stalemate situation where an AL doesn't want to commit to a fight. Ubalist doesn't really want to commit to a fight, so they're just sort of waiting for one hero to get a little bit out of position.
For AL, they're waiting for Shaitan to have that BKB done. And once that BKB is actually now done?
Yeah, he is.
All right, so now AL can look to initiate. They've already got Blink, they've already got the BKB. Lich Ultimate's up, Snoopy's Ultimate's up. Ritzker's walking around with... Looks like he's actually working towards a Bloodstone, but I got a funny feeling he's going to switch himself into a pipe.
Oh, Tinker on bottom here has got his TP canceled.
Oh, he's going to be trouble. Sunstrike will miss, however.
TP is coming in.
And there goes the dust.
Dust pops.
But Shaitan's got high movement speed with that Ghost Walk. Well, even just by himself with a drum charge.
And he's tracked Tinker, so he gets a little bit of bonus move speed when Tinker's nearby.
Easy to know what's going on. And now they're going to go Roshan. Yeah, Roshan's back up, so Ublis is going to head in for that one. But they're going to lose their tier 1 tower on the top lane for it. They do have Fortification, and as well as the Prophet Ultimate. And that is just going to annoy the living crap out of Musica. He'll be forced back, and Roshan's almost dead, basically. 2k, 1k, and then zilch.
And Snoopy still hasn't revealed the fact that he's got a Blink Dagger.
Man, I love that on the top line. I don't know if you saw Tinker was going to TP himself in. And Musica just said, I dare you. I will stand my ground. No one else is coming to help you. We'd be quite happy to kill you. We've got 4 heroes up here. What have you got? Rotation. Yeah, that's going to take time.
Windrunner's got to be careful here. Might get caught out by Shaitan's going to scout.
Yep, he's going to find Iron Man as well as... Well, actually, no, VS is a little bit further away. But Iron Man's in a really bad position. Fidget's there, track as well. Falling out with a stomp and the meteorite. They've got to hold him out of place. And VS swaps him back, actually, in range of Risk. So Vengeful Spirit will probably take a fall right now. Shaitan will pop that BKB. Shuri Toss doesn't get the last hit. And now the Black Hole pulling Musica back in again. But there's that Lich Ullman stunning him off. So Enigma, even with his own BKB, cancelling off the Black Hole. Getting hit and hit, but takes no damage. Musica jumps inside his walk and Risk will TP out. So Bounty Hunter for the Windrunner. VS limping back to base. Does Invoker have Sunstrike? If he, in
he
one second he will.
Fight.
But he can jump himself out again. Sorry, Invoke again. He's not going to. Alex is already safe.
And that's what Ubalist has to be careful of, is that the Bounty Hunter's going to be scouting ahead, so until they get a gem, they've got to be grouped up when, even in their own forest, unless they know where everybody on Absolute Legends is.
Well, they are walking around with dust and ward, so they'll be prepared if something does happen. But you're right, that initial, like, now we actually know something is coming at us, instead of, like, I think something is there, maybe I should pop my dust. Changes the way you approach it all. Is that Risk now getting his Bloodstone? Yeah, it is. So Risk gets Bloodstone. Takes him 30 minutes to get that pretty raw Bloodstone out from Lashrak. But for him, he'll still think it's worth it.
Another thing we should note is that actually Lich Ultimate, although it does no damage to Enigma when he's BKB'd, it still does stun him. So even if he pops the BKB and goes into the black hole, Lich can still take him out of it.
That's exactly what he did. And Naaman got himself a pretty decent black hole. If that black hole continued, then AL would not have got out of that fight the way they did. Now Godot, oh man, Alex is there. Shackle will lash, but Snoopy blinks up as well. Power shot to fly through. Fission now will go. Shaitan just destroys the Vengeful Spirit. Now Prophet's going to TP in. Sprout holding off Godot as well. Snoopy, big Echo Slam going to go through. It won't be enough damage to get the kills. And in fact, even Necro units coming out to fight that one. Bounty Hunter so lucky to escape out of that. VS the only one to take a fall for the Dire side, but losing Lich in the ES for it.
And these are Necro 3 units, so Bounty Hunter's got to be really careful.
Down right click those guys down, not without taking a decent chunk of pure damage.
Oh, and they give True Sight at level 3.
Good point. Who needs Walls and Dust when you got True Sight on little portable Necro units? Meteorite just trying to burn up whatever life points of this creep wave there are. I don't know if they can hold this. Lightning from Risk should actually destroy off majority of this wave as well as do some decent damage to pass. Track goes up again too, so AL has some decent vision. There's the TP, Shackle, latches music of a Snoopy's gonna come in, blinks off to the side so he can get himself a good line for the fissure so he can do so. Pass takes a fall. Shaitan wants to keep going, pops the BKB so the stun won't remain. Leaf trying to hex up Godot, but he's got to add some pressure to him. That's where the BKB popped up from Shaitan. Has he got enough right click damage? Yes, he does. Aegis will pop. RMN wants to continue to fight. That's why the wind run pops off, so he gets the evasion, so he doesn't get right click down. Risk, there goes Edict damage, so what? Even if he dies, I'll still do it. Now the Lejomba going to bounce around, back into Leaf, up onto RMN, and Chill trying to hold Snoopy as well as Music are in place, pulling him back over the fissure. There goes Chill, double kill for the Lich, and the laser popping off the kill on the bounty, and he's going to retreat back around again. Leaf with a decent amount of life and health. VS swapping Music back in again, follows up with a stun. Wonderful shackles while Musica and Risk held in place, and that's gonna be another kill for Tinker. Triple kill for him. Alex helping out, so does RMM with the shackles. But Shaitan keeps that track going. He wants in. Is there a gem? I think there is a dust. That is what is up. Howl and Power Shot will fly through. And Shaitan's revealed. Prophet's gonna TP in for this one as well. And there goes the Sprout. Pops off the Necro units, they can keep seeing Shaitan. Fissure trying to pop up there by Snoopy, but what a time for a Hex from Leaf. Unable to buy time for his teammates. Snoopy, is there a rearm? No, there is enough mana for it, but a right click damage will be enough. Tinker gets another one on the top lane. Now 18 to 24 in favor of Ubalist. And they are thinking about going. In fact, they are. They're going to go in.
They're going to take the base tower.
They've got enough to push with. Maybe Risk with the lightning damage might push them out a little bit more. And the TP, VS swapped swapping in. Risk back in again. But he starts off with a pulse. Echo slam from Snoopy. They need that right click on Alex and then get it as well. Rockets will fly. AL will hold the line up against Ubalist.
That was a really, really long fight there. He had buybacks from Bounty Hunter. And just the stability there of Ubalist. They managed to keep heroes in there for a long, long time at very low life and managed to not actually end up going down.
Worked a charm for them in the end. How do we end up looking as far as gold experience? Only, well, it's still going the normal trend. Okay, maybe experience goes a little bit further. The 14k in the end for experience for Ubalist, 12k as far as gold goes.
And Tinker, of course, had a sheepstick that fight, which really, really helped to get some extra disable out for Ubalist.
Well, they
and I was waiting for that Enigma black hole. As soon as Lich ultimate popped, I thought, or went on somebody else, I thought Enigma was going to pop it, but I think he waited just a tad too long.
He had to make sure too it was going to bounce, and the damage the Lich ultimate did was, at the end of the day, he had to wait for that positioning. You can't control the bounce yourself. That would be way too OP. Yeah. we're going to see yes. Snoopy as well as Shaitan come in. And they're looking for pass. Pass goes to the side. Tinker TP's out. And they've got to get the kill on Ninja's Prophet. Shaitan being revealed off by those level 3 Necro units. Fissure doesn't go. And now pass inside the trees. They're not going to find him. Riss tries to come through with a stun, but it's already too late. Protecting that's himself the in the fog of war. Oh, man. Music is going to be in real trouble. Hex starts off, RMN now has himself a She-Stick, and Leaf will follow up with his Shackles there as well. Halaterra dropping the armor of Musical, so Tinker can just laser him to death. Leaf looking really good right now. What is he at now? 9-1 and 177 CS.
Yeah, Leaf's been doing very, very well this game. He's going Blacking Bar now, just to prevent some of AL's disables. Allow him to TP out freely if he needs to.
I love, interesting too, that music can pull back instantly. It's like, no matter what, I need to be on these lanes, and we need to be pushing out.
Yeah. Just got a little bit of a accidental pause, I think.
Saw Diamond leave, like, no! Okay.
I think we're going to see a sheep stick up from Prophet soon, which is just going to add to Absolute Legends' trouble. I mean, we've already got one from Windrunner. We've got one on the Tinker.
Well, that's a never-ending one on the Tinker. Rearm resets that every time.
Yeah, but now they can disable two players, one forever and somebody else once with the Windrunner sheep.
Surprising though, the Tinkerer is going to go for a BKB. That's one thing the rearm doesn't affect. But he must really feel a little bit unsettled when it comes to the fight. So when it comes to pushing lanes,
he just doesn't want to get shuriken tossed down when he's trying to TP away. I think. I mean, you've also got the long range of the Earthshaker, and Invoker's Cold Snap's got long range as well. So overall, it's just sort of a safety thing. Mm. You don't want to take unnecessary risks, and his farm's good enough at this point that he can afford a blocking bar, and it'll also let him, of course, tank up some damage on the front lines, not being disabled. So there's nothing at this point that can go through blocking bar on AL side, except for the Lich ultimate as a stun. Mm-hmm.
Wow, they managed to bait out the Necro units out from pass. He's not going to be 100% happy with that one. And they're going to try and get a kill on Shaitan, but look at Shaitan. Pops the haste rune the second he gets hexed. Making sure he gets himself a very, very fast piglet-ing away. But AL will want to initiate on this one. What do we got from Invoker? He's still got Forge Spirit Cold Snap. He wants an opening. He might be able to claim one too.
Yubelist are wisely backing off here. And they knew that the Necro units got a little bit baited out, so they'll use them to push out the lane, but don't want to commit to a fight at this point.
Alex, a little bit of trouble right now. I think he knows it too. We've got Roshan up in about maybe 5-10 seconds. And this is going to be AL's time. Leaf will push through the bottom lane. And yeah, now Roshan, yep, they know it. Risk is there. They don't want Ubelus getting the Aegis and Cheese. They're going to have to fight. They're to fight in the middle lane. Yeah, he's picked up right now. Leaver's going to be there. Sprout holding him in place. In comes Snoopy. Good Echo Slam, but he couldn't get the Fissure off in time. The follow-up stuns were just too fast from Ubelus. Clearing up the trees in case AL was there, and AL was there. They retreat themselves out and go, this is not where we really want to be. TP back to the base and defend. Bounty Hunter will buy it back, but ES is down. Echo Slam is gone, and Ubelus will smoke and rush.
Yeah, they baited out the buyback from Bounty Hunter, so they know that they don't need to push here. They've already claimed themselves a little bit of a victory, and they'll take Roshan on top of it.
This is just one of those times, man. One of those times when you get really, really frustrated, and I love, too, just the fact that Leaf can saturate this completely with the regen. Rearm, march, rearm, march, rearm, march, rearm, march. In comes the Sunstrike, killing off one of the trees, but it's already too late. Aegis goes to Leaf, Cheese goes to RMN.
He's still using that regen rune. That's the power of Tinkers with regen and Storm Spirits with regen. It's just you can burn through your entire mana pool, do everything you want.
It's the wonders of anyone with regen. It's beautiful. And Tinker now finishes up the BKB after the Rosh kill. Doesn't enough a buyback, but at this point when you hold all your tier 2 towers, why would you give two hoots?
He's got an Aegis as well, so mm-hmm. He's not too worried.
Yeah, just in case AL locks him down. Which at this point, they don't really have anything which can do so. Those targeted stuns are pretty much out the window. They need the burst damage to kill him off. And while he's walking around with a BKB as well as the normal farm he's got, it's difficult to do. Top lane push now going to come out from Ubelist. Support is already there, and the Pipe pops as well. So let's start off with the March. Fidget's there, holding the creep wave off, and now comes the Meteorite. A little bit off target there by Musica. Following up now with a spin. to try and slow down this creep wave. Focus fire onto the tower, but Fortification will slow down Ubalist again. Lightning as well. There's this wonderful turtle lineup from AL. And it's difficult for them to come in close range to the tower. RMM will get the kill on the tower. VS Force will swap him away, realizing he's in too close. Track and toss pop off, and three units currently tracked up from Ubalist. If they want to push in right now, it could be costly for them. And I really do mean costly.
Tinker is TPing right in.
Yep, Snoopy comes up towards the front lines, but he gets hexed up, and Tinker will take care of him. Laser rockets, and Enigma with a stun. BKB is up. He finds Shatan, but decides not to in the end, looking for risk, and he gets the BKB up on him. Now the Chomper going to bounce up, and then bounce into the creep wave a little bit more. Bounty looking for a kill here on Leaf, and Chill will take a fall. Is there a toss? No, it's on cooldown right now, and Chill, no. He gets away safely. Leaf will stand his ground, while Ryclick's trying to come out from Music Ring. Won't get shackled. Leaf will pop off the Aegis of the Immortal. Risk on the run with a pulse, but the right click damage out from Ubalist is just way too much for Risk to really deal with. And Enigma decides to come back in again. Mechas off cooldown, he's already used a stick charger, so why not? Top rack's gone. Hex down by, four staff down by Leaf, looking for Godot again. Has he got a Hex? Yeah, he does. As well as Rocket, as well as Laser. And it's almost enough to kill him off until Music forces them back there. In range of the tier 4 towers, and then swapped in range for the mid, where Ubalist will look towards the next racks.
And mid racks will go down here, and I wouldn't be surprised to even see them rotate again for bottom racks and take all three in one swift motion.
It won't be hard for them.
And Leshrac actually died in the last fight because Edict accidentally killed the Necrobook.
And just the luck of everything that happens. Godot's Hex, Snoopy is Hexed right now. Got a big follow-up stunned. They want to get the kill on Music before he gets back inside the base. And yeah, there goes Godot in the back end of play. Wrist back up again. Nice stun there on Leaf.
Leaf's going to go down.
Snoopy is still going to call the GG well played. Got to remember the time ranking. But it is going to be Ubalist just to continue to push in and finish the game. And the Rockets will go and actually takes a bit of a U-turn in the air. That one's a Heat Seeker on Music after the swap. They're going to keep playing, but Ubalist will push as fast as they can. Tier 4 tower to be brought down. 42-25 at the moment on the clock. Trying to do whatever they can to bring down this throne in a decent amount of time. Not delay the game, but Risk as well as Music being a bit of a pain in the ass. But 42-35 will be the final one, and AL finding themselves again with no victory in the defense. What have they got so far in their group?
They're 1-1 now. They beat Hydra as their first game. So they're not looking too terribly, but they're going to want to get a couple wins to make sure they make it into the playoff stage.
Well, that holds them in third position looking at those scores, and it puts Ubalist locked together, being undefeated with Complexity Gaming in Group 2. We are now, of course, going to jump ourselves into our next game, which will be starting up very, very soon. 4FC going up against a Moscow 5 will be the next one. Moscow 5 as well as 4FC have actually from exactly the same group, and both teams currently winless in this group 2, who will finally get themselves up on the board and tie themselves up with absolute legends in that third position. You'll find out in a moment. Stick around, guys.
I said good day, sir!